This is TALKish. I am Halli Casser-Jayne. TALKish is available at hallicasser-jayne.com. Now, let's get to it. On this episode of TALKish, I visit with J. Randy Taraborrelli, the author of Jackie, Janet, and Lee, the dazzling new and controversial biography of three of the most glamorous women of the 20th century, Jacqueline Bouvier Kennedy Onassis, her mother, Janet Lee Auchincloss, and her sister, Princess Lee Radziwill. And in our second half hour, we'll take a look at the science of popularity with the author of Hitmakers, Atlantic senior editor Derek Thompson. Up first is Randy Taraborrelli. The story of Janet, Jackie, and Lee begins like this. The year is 1951, at one of their mother-daughter teas, a favorite tradition of shopping and gossip, when the mother, Janet Norton Lee Bouvier Auchincloss Morris, asked her daughters, Jacqueline Lee Bouvier, one day to add Kennedy and Onassis to her name, and Caroline Lee Bouvier, one day to add Canfield, then Radziwill, then Ross to her name, "Do you know what the secret to happily ever after is?" Before they could answer, Janet did. Money and power. The daughters learned their mother's lessons well, their stories told in the oh my gosh, you cannot put it down biography, Jackie, Janet, and Lee. By the author of nearly 20 biographies that became New York Times bestsellers, including After Camelot and The Secret Life of Marilyn Monroe, J. Randy Taraborrelli. Taking a page from their mother's playbook and her marriage to their handsome, philandering, socialite father, BlackJack Bouvier, and the fabulously rich Standard Oil heir, Hugh D. Auchincloss, Jackie would marry John F. Kennedy, who would become the most powerful man in the world as U.S. president and one of the richest men in the world, Greek shipping magnate Aristotle Onassis. Younger sister Lee would add princess to her title. Beauty, style, fashion, wealth, the world was their stage. But behind every curtain, there is much to be revealed. Taraborrelli does just that. It's time for TALKish. Let's talk with the author of Jackie, Janet, and Lee, J. Randy Taraborrelli. You must have had a blast writing this.
Well, I really did because, for me, it's always interesting doing something about a subject that is so well covered, like Jackie,
It's just hard to believe that nobody took it from your angle before. I mean, it's just wild.
Surprising.
Nice hole found. I got to give you credit for that.
Thanks. You know, it's when I did Jackie, Ethel, Joan, Women of Camelot, the women who married into the family, people asked me the same question, you know, how is it that no one has done this before? You know, I'm just glad that I was able to do it.
Did you find it or did it pop into your head one night? This is a great angle. How did that happen?
No, what happened was while I was researching After Camelot, somebody sent me a video of Jackie at a party. And she was looking beautiful and gorgeous in yellow dress. And he said, who are these people in this picture? And I took a look at Jackie. She's having a great time at this party. Everyone in the photograph was somebody, or everyone in the footage was somebody I did not recognize. There were no Kennedys anywhere. And I thought, how is it possible that Jackie in 1966, 67 could be, at a social function without any Kennedys? You know, it just seems like so out of context, you know, from what we knew about her. And so I did some research. It turned out that this was footage from her half-sister, Janet Jr.'s wedding reception at Hammersmith. And after I got past the question, who the heck is Janet Jr., then I started researching the book. And wow, Janet Jr. is a big character in this book, you know, and she's somebody that was very close to Jackie. And I just think that, you know, discovering new characters like that is really what this kind of research is all about.
Oh, absolutely. So let me take it from here. Jackie, Janet, Lee. I mean, as I said to you, it absolutely is phenomenal. It doesn't disappoint. It's fascinating. It's engaging. First of all, you're a good writer too. But I even put that second to the content, which is like,
thank you.
Oh my God. So let's start with this mother, Janet, which most of us don't know. You know, we at that certain age, I really knew nothing much about the mother. So, you know, so little's been written about her. But who was she, Randy? Where did she come from? What drove her? I mean, what's the story with this woman? Give me something on this Janet.
Well, Janet Lee, comes to life in this book, I think, largely because her only son, Jamie, spent more than 40 hours, explaining his mom to me and her relationship with his half-sisters, Jackie and Lee. And when you have the only surviving son of the main subject of your book, giving you, family stories and mementos and photographs and trivia like that, you can really bring a woman to life. And Janet was just somebody who was just such an unusual person because she, not to be indelicate, but, she had a strong sex drive, which was unusual for women of her time in the 1940s who, were a little bit more circumspect about it. Janet was a very passionate person. She enjoyed her relationship with her first husband, Jack Bouvier, even though it had its downside because he was unfaithful to her, chronically so. But they had a chemistry that she could not deny, and I thought that was so interesting. I always wondered why Janet and Jack Bouvier stayed together, and I realized that it was for that common thing that we've all experienced, hopefully, at one time or another in our lifetimes, which is, passion. And then she, bucked her father and society conventions at that time and divorced him and married a man named Hugh Auchincloss that she really didn't have that same passion for. But she traded in that passion in order to give her daughters and herself the kind of lifestyle that she so wanted. And Hugh was very wealthy, and he was a very nice man, and they stayed married for many, many, many years. And, Janet gave her daughters a lot of life lessons, and some that may have served them and some that may have not, but she definitely was very protective and very much a present mom in their lives.
Did she come from money? Explain that to people.
Yes.
Right,
yes.
Right. So that she understood, I think that's important as you look at the story. She understood what money meant, what power meant, what poverty could mean. And
you're absolutely right about that. And a lot of people, and I love the way that you frame that, because it's real easy to look at these women as just being mercenary and not understanding that what they really wanted was to take care of themselves, to find a way to take care of themselves. And, when Janet married Hugh Auchincloss, he made it very clear that his money was going to be going to his natural born children, the children he had before he met Janet. And so she knew from the start that if Jackie and Lee wanted to continue the lifestyle that they had gotten used to as teenagers, they were going to have to do something. And it was going to be more than marrying a plumber from New Jersey,
Now I'm from New Jersey.
Believe me, stop that. Listen, my cousin is a plumber from New Jersey.
So, okay.
I mean, I'm from Philadelphia, so I've got no problem with New Jersey. But what I'm saying is that, that they knew the kind of man that they wanted, or at least Jackie did. You know, Lee had a lot of confusion about this, and Lee's sort of the moral compass to our story, in the sense that she always wanted more than just money and power. She was romantic. She was idealistic. She fell in love easily, and she was just a whimsical kind of wonderful person who always went up against her mom and Jackie when it came to this family mandate of money and power.
There are two things that crossed my mind. One is, I don't know if you thought about this when you were writing it, but I was thinking about it. The two girls remind me a little bit of Queen Elizabeth and her sister. What's her name? My brain just went dead.
Margaret. Margaret, yes.
Right, it's Monday. Last night was a long night. There's a similarity in that, and I don't know if that's firstborn, secondborn, that comes into play as to how, sisters would gaze at life and look at life or take the life lessons that a mother might had. I want to go back to Janet for one second, because there's some crazy little thing in here. The girls, which most of us did not know, had these half-brother and a half-sister, right? I mean, artificial insemination?
Yeah, well, there you go. I mean, this is a woman who would not accept no for an answer. And when Hugh Auchincloss told her that they would not be having sex because he was chronically impotent, she was okay with it, though she couldn't understand why he was okay with it. I mean, in her mind, you wouldn't accept anything like this. You would find an alternative. You would fight. You would not accept any limitation. But when they married, she decided, I've had a couple kids, so it's no big deal. I've had sex in the past, so I'm okay. I'm good to go, right? Except when she was a young woman. I mean, she was only in her early 40s, you know, and she realized after a while that, wait a second, I think I want children with this man. I mean, I think I do. And so she went to New York, and at this time in the 1940s, you know, they were pioneering the idea of what they called test tube babies at that time. And a doctor explained to Janet, you know, how artificial insemination would work. And she, after she heard this story, she thought it was way too complicated, there was a much easier solution, she decided. And she went about the business of finding an easier solution using what I imagine would be, you know, some kitchen utensils, you know.
I mean, it gives the nobody insight quite, into her, nobody, right, yeah.
I mean, nobody quite remembers how she did it, you know, like, they're not, like, her family members aren't even sure, because this isn't something that she, you know, openly discussed at the dinner table, so there's a little bit of speculation as to how she did it, but she did it in some way that worked.
Yeah, unbelievable woman, just an unbelievable woman. I mean, you have to think about it. I want to talk, guys, I'm going to have to cut you off 1,000 times, I'm sure, because I'm going to get to everything I want to get to.
Sure,
I want to talk a little bit also about their biological father, Jack Black. What was his name? This guy,
Blackjack.
I mean, this guy is sexy, fabulous. Oh my God. You know, I mean, he's every bad boy that we ever wanted to know, because, you know, women love bad boys, particularly when they're young. I always thought, and I wanted to throw this out to you, because we know that Jackie then goes ahead and she marries, you know, Jack Kennedy, who cheats on her. And then later, Onassis, he's got power and money. And I always thought that, I'm curious what you would think about this. I'm jumping ahead of the game, but I thought she married her father first, and she married her mother in her second marriage, Jackie.
Wow, that's interesting. Yeah, that's interesting. I see how you come to that conclusion.
I'm reading your book, and I'm thinking, this is so clear to me, the psychological ramifications of what was presented to her.
Yeah, I mean, you know, she and Lee both had such admiration for their dad, but they both also knew, you know, who he was. And what he was. And, you know, Jackie and Janet both agreed that infidelity was something that they were not going to accept in a marriage because of the way Black Jack had treated Janet. Lee had a lot more latitude where this was concerned. You know, Lee was not as rigid about this as her mom and her sister were. And this is one of the reasons why there was always so much confusion regarding Aristotle Onassis and Lee, because Lee didn't feel that she could be open with her mom and her sister about her affair with Onassis because she knew they wouldn't approve.
Yeah, we have to talk about,
so
let me stop you there for a second, because we were ahead of ourselves. Lee has an affair with Onassis long before Jackie, which the Kennedys went bananas over. And that's a little known part of the story. And then Jackie marries him, which we'll talk about the relationship between the two girls. But go ahead. I'm sorry.
Sure.
But I thought we should put that in there so people know what we're talking
about. Well, yeah. I mean, Lee's relationship with Onassis started in 1962. Jackie's didn't really start until 1967.
Right.
And you were talking earlier about the crown. And it's so interesting that when I was writing this book, there was a scene in The Crown where the queen makes her sister give up the man that she's in love with. And their mother says, you know, you have to do this for your sister. She's the queen. And the girl says, well, what has she ever done for me? You know, and that scene aired at the same time that I was writing a scene in which Jackie has to give up, I mean, in which Lee is asked to give up Onassis because Jackie is in the White House and Janet doesn't want Lee to bring this scandal to the White House doors, you know. And, you know, Lee says something like that. She's, you know, well, what has she ever done for me? Why do I have to do this? And it's that sort of self-sacrifice that Lee was always asked to do for Jackie that I think is something that people just don't know about. I mean, Lee gave up Onassis for Jackie twice. And the first time in 1962, and then the second time again in 1968. And, you know, I think that kind of sacrifice is...
Yeah, it's a big deal. It's a big deal.
Big deal,
it's
yeah.
It's a big deal. It's these two girls, the older sister, Jackie, four or five years younger sister, Lee... Both beautiful girls. I've always thought Lee was much prettier than Jackie, but that's personal taste, I'm sure. Certainly more refined looking, more stylish, more... I mean, she was put together in a way. And I don't know that she ever got the kind of credit that she got because she was always the second sister compared to the first lady, this, that, and the other thing. But this schism between them, they start off as I think that was always there, but at least they went to Europe as kids together. They did stuff together, and then it just, you know, and we'll get to the end at the end of the of our conversation, but it just deteriorated into horror. But why? Mother set them up to be competitive, do you think, or what was your feelings on that?
I really do. I think that, you know, we have stories in the book where Janet would always tell her daughters, you know, I don't approve of competition between you two. I do not approve of that. And she didn't. And I want you two to be supportive of each other and to be there for each other. And she felt that way. But then after she would have that talk with them, she would take Jackie by the hand and go shopping and leave poor Lee behind. Mm-hmm. And I think that when you're 7, 8, 9 years old, that this sticks with you. And Janet inadvertently created a competition between Lee and Jackie that was really one-sided, and it was all Lee's side. Jackie never was in competition with Lee. It was always Lee in competition with Jackie. And I think that you're right. I think that their mom inadvertently created this, and it just really always, it always stuck. And when Jackie finally became first lady, I think that was so sort of disheartening to Lee, because how do you compete with that?
You can't.
You know?
Yeah, you can't.
But maybe it was the best thing that ever happened, because it was after that that Lee began to really go in search of her own identity. And then she started tackling all sorts of careers and creativity, and she aspired to do so much. And I think it was because she finally realized that she was never going to really be able to compete with her sister, so maybe it's time for her to figure out who she is, right, separate and apart from that competition.
And play, and play. And I think the other part of it that I got out of what, you know, the book is that Jackie was perfect. Jackie was like formed. She was going to be perfect at everything she did, the perfect daughter. You know, she was going to listen to every word that her mother said to do, and she was going to do it, and she was going to do it better. And then Lee is the creative, artful one. And, you know, in the mother's world, it was, you know, screw money, screw art, screw whatever, money, power. And didn't understand who Lee was probably as well as she might. And probably Lee probably had more of her father's character traits, I think, than she did.
I think you're right. Yeah. And I think Lee just had more fun.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, Lee just...
being Jackie. I've got news for you. Who'd want to be first lady? You know,
and also, Jackie had all that horrible tragedy in her life, you know, that was just so debilitating that, you know, Lee didn't have to experience in the same way. So, you know, they had such completely different lives, you know, that, I mean, they're so different in so many ways, you know. But what I really love in the book more than anything is when Lee decides that she wants to make a documentary about her and her sister, Jackie. And Jackie and Lee both go to Janet's attic, and they do a sort of a search for mementos. And, you know, they try to find pictures and keepsakes. And in the course of all that, as I wrote, they find some letters from Blackjack to Janet that they'd never seen before. And they read these letters, and the sisters, in reading these letters, realize that they have so much in common with their mom, and that, you know, Jack Kennedy and Aristotle Onassis and Prince Radziwill and these men who cheated on them were very much like their father, who cheating on their mom. And it was in that moment that I think that they realized, oh my gosh, we are all living the exact same experience.
And that's eye-opening. Totally, for any, you know, a pair of sisters, you know, and sisters, that's a tough thing. You're a guy, you didn't have sister in terms of, you know, two girls together. I came from that background. There's a really unusual dynamic to that. I kind of want to say, I don't want to dwell a lot about Jack, because, you know, President Kennedy, because I think a lot of us already know the story about him per se. But I wanted to speak about Jackie in this respect, because my recollections, and I was just a girl when all of this was going on, but my recollections of her, and even when you see the movie that was done recently on of her, that whisper, and both girls, by the way, had that whisper, had that Marilyn Monroe kind of breathless thing going on. I mean, did you come away thinking that Jackie was contrived, that Jackie was real? We'll get to Lee in a minute, but who was Jackie? Did she ever regret anything? Did she ever say, oh my God, if I had done it this way, I wouldn't have, before she went? She was so...
I think that she, it would appear that way, but I think that there is more heart and more pain there. And I think that a lot of what we saw was covering all that up. You know, I mean, she lost two children. You know, she lost her husband. She lost her stepson, Alexander Onassis. She lost her brother-in-law, Bobby. I mean, there's a lot of pain, a lot of loss. And I think that, you know, I mean, I knew Jackie Onassis. I mean,
really?
You know, yeah. And when I was at Doubleday, when I was a kid for writing my first book, it was because of Jackie. She brought me to Doubleday. And so but this isn't to say that I ever had any conversations with her about any of that. It's just to say that I sure did want to.
Well, you saw her in a different light than most of us would see her, too. So that's interesting.
Well, yeah. And I saw her as an editor and as a mentor. And I saw, sort of interesting stories that Michael Jackson was a friend of mine, and Michael Jackson felt about Jackie the way that I did. And when Jackie was going to edit his book, Michael called me and he said, I'm going to ask her every question I've ever wanted to ask her. I'm going to ask her about Dallas. I'm going to ask her about Bobby. I'm going to ask her. And I was like, Michael, you'll never ask her these questions. I mean, you'll never do that. He said, no, I'm going to do it. And then he had his first meeting with her, and he called me the next day and he said, dude, I couldn't do any of that. Because when she was with you, she was so nice and so welcoming that you would never want to return her to this dark time in her life. You just wouldn't do that to her. And that's the effect that she had on people. She made you want to protect her. And I think that, you know, as a country, we feel still very protective of Jackie. And anytime I criticize her in interviews, I immediately get, you know, email from people saying, you know, how could you say that about her? How can you say that about her? When actually all I'm trying to do is just explain her humanity, you know,
but
I'm not trying to be.
Right. I hear you. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you have to say this about her, too. She did something that I don't think any other first lady, in a way, has ever done. Her husband is killed. She could have played the widow the rest of her life. It was the perfect setup. You see political women do it all the time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And she did not. She didn't go there, which to some is still an irritant. You know, there are a lot in the Democratic Party who wish she had stayed and played the widow, you know, for the rest of her life and whatever, hoping that she would have lived longer than she did. But she didn't. She said, I'm not going to do that. And she had the courage to go out and she found herself another life and made another life. Became the editor, you know, became another.
Yeah.
You have to give her credit for that. She could have just sat on the laurels and been a Kennedy and the grieving widow
the rest of her
life.
For the rest of her life. And she made it really, really clear. She said, I am not going to be the Kennedy widow for the rest of my life. And a lot of that had to do with what she felt was best for her children. You know, I mean, she went forward as much for her children as she did for herself. I think she knew that she had to bounce back. I mean, she went through a very, very dark time after JFK, and everybody in her life knew it. And a lot of people felt that she wasn't even in her right mind when she married Onassis, and that a lot of those decisions were PTSD related, you know. But she did, as you say, make a decision to go on with her life. And
That's something.
She certainly did.
Right, that's
It's amazing, yeah.
I knew him, by the way, so I have my time with him. And he was charming. He was fun. Onassis. He was fun.
Oh, you really? Is that right?
That's right.
Wow.
So,
no kidding.
There you go, right?
There you go.
I was very young.
That you don't hear too often.
Oh, I was very young when I met him, and a very good friend of mine in a private girls' school I was in, father was in business with him. And so we were at a party, and there he was for giving the party, actually, in New York.
Wow.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
And he was fun.
Yeah. I think that what you get from him in this book is, you know, I wanted to show a different side of Onassis, and I just wanted to show him as more of a person than, you know,
that
maybe
people want us to think that he was. I mean, he was many things, I think, to many people, and I think one of his gifts, like Jackie's, he could be whatever you wanted him to be, because that's always the talent of somebody who knows how to do that. I want to get back to Lee, because she's fascinating. So she has all these marriages, the prince, the this, that, tragic life in a lot of ways. With all the good things that came to her, as many bad things. She loses a son who's only 40 years old from cancer.
Yeah.
You know, the marriages don't work. She fights alcoholism, like her dad, depression, that kind of thing. And at the end, when Jackie's dying, this part was hard for me, that Jackie, knowing and pushing her all those years, saying, look, you know, you got to get some money going here. You got to get a little... doesn't leave her even a memento in her will.
Yeah.
And by the way, we could talk about, you might want to talk about it, about how Janet dies of Alzheimer's and the elder abuse. So maybe you want to pull all of that together as we kind of bring this to a close.
Well, yeah. Look, I mean, you know, as a historian, I'm sort of tethered to the facts, obviously. But I have to say that throughout this entire book, I kept screaming at my computer screen for these women to please sit down and have a conversation. You know, could you please just have that conversation that you so desperately need, in which you really are vulnerable to each other and you express your hurt and your pain so that this story can have a better ending. I mean, I wanted this story to have a happier ending than it has. And, you know, at the end of the day, you know, Jackie is there for her mom during this Alzheimer's development in Janet's life, and Jackie is there when she believes that her mom is a victim of elder abuse at the hands of her third husband, Bingham Morris. And Lee is not able to be there for any of this because she just doesn't have that strength, that resolve, that thing that Jackie had, you know, that Lee didn't have it. I mean, it was too hard for her to be there. And I think that in many ways, Jackie resented that. And I don't even think she realized it while it was happening. I think it's something that she came to after her mom was gone and she had a chance to think about it. And she hadn't had a chance to work through these feelings when she died. And I think that when she made that decision about her will, I think that she was probably angry at her sister. And I think that maybe all that could have been reconciled if they had had more time. You know, but these things, maybe the object lesson here is, you know, you don't have all the time in the world to straighten these things out with a sibling, and you need to find a way to straighten it out when you can. And they really did not straighten it out. So I wish that they had, but I would say that they did not.
So there are two parts to the ending of this. One is that Lee is, what, about 84, 85 now? Still beautiful. Not much money. Not much money, right? You didn't talk to her, did you?
Enough to take care. She got a good settlement from her last husband.
Okay.
But that didn't happen until she was in her mid-60s. And a lot of people were feeling, wow, you know, she's gone to the dark side with her mom and her sister. But as I wrote in the book, I think her mom and her sister would probably finally have been proud of her for finally taking care of herself. Because what are you going to do in your mid-60s? Another documentary? Another book? Another career? No, you've really got to figure out a way, and Lee finally did. So that's a good thing.
But here's the part. So Lee has a surviving daughter, Princess Anna Christina Radziwill, and then of course there's Carolyn Kennedy Schlossberg. And you know, all I could think, Randy, when I'm reading this, is did the legacy pass on? Who are these women? Does that formidable side go forward? Or does the artful side go forward? And I think if you look at the two daughters, you see just how much those two Bouvier girls left as legacies to their children and to us. It's extraordinary. Great book you wrote.
Well, you know, thank you very much. And, you know, that takes me to, you know, the book I'm finishing right now. It's due actually March 1st. It's The Kennedys, The Next Generation, in which, you know, I bring to light all of those questions that you just posed. And there's a lot of lineage questions that are referenced in my next book, which is The Next Generation. And it's Caroline Kennedy and all the rest of them and their stories. So it's pretty interesting.
Call me when it's done, darling. We'll have you back.
I will.
I love this. I love you. Thanks so much for coming on the show and talking to me. Just a great book.
Thank you so much for the interview. I really appreciate
it. Right. I've been speaking with J. Randy Taraborrelli, the author of Jackie, Janet, and Lee, The Secret Lives of Janet Auchincloss and Her Daughters, Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis and Princess Lee Radziwill. For more information on the book and Randy Taraborrelli's other works, visit his website at jrandytaraborrelli.com. You are listening to Talkish, the Halli Casser-Jayne Show. My guests today are J. Randy Taraborrelli, the author of Jackie, Janet, and Lee, and Derek Thompson, the author of Hitmakers. Talkish, the Halli Casser-Jayne Show, posts new podcasts Wednesdays, 3 p.m. Eastern at hallicasserjayne.com. Now, original, fascinating, and deeply entertaining, Derek Thompson's hitmakers, The Science of Popularity in the Age of Distraction, is a confetti of an astonishing thinker's ideas that uncovers the hidden psychology of why we like what we like, a revelatory cornucopia of the economics of cultural markets that invisibly shape our lives. Hitmaking, or why some things become popular and others do not, shatters the sentimental myths of popularity that have dominated pop culture and business in the past. Thompson shows quality is insufficient for success and slams the body culture, boldly asserting that nobody has good taste. And there's this. The consumers that matter the most aren't the early adopters, but rather their friends, followers, and imitators. Yet although it may be a new world, there remain many enduring truths to what audience and consumers want. Applying cutting-edge science to stories of hits across the decades, including recent sensations, Thompson reveals how each blockbuster actually has a secret history of power, influence, dark broadcasters, and passionate cults that turn some new products into cultural phenomena. Hitmakers is a captivating jaunt for those looking for the formula for success by Derek Thompson, senior editor at The Atlantic Magazine, where he writes about economics and the media. It's time for Talkish. Let's talk with the author of Hitmakers, Derek Thompson. Listen to me. This is such an enlightening set of ideas. I just, wow, I was really caught up in this. I didn't know that I would be quite the way that I was. It's like, it's a labyrinth you take us through. Start here. Why'd you write Hitmakers, and did you believe you could discover a formula to making a hit? What was this exercise all about for you?
That's a good question. I guess, you know, I'm just inherently interested in popularity. When a song I think is terrible becomes popular, I want to know why. When a movie that I think is awesome becomes popular, I want to know why. And so because this was such a tantalizing subject, I thought it would be a great subject for a book. And indeed, it was so much fun to report, to go through pop culture history and sort of pick off all of these little stories and then talk to academics about the science of why we like what we like, why ideas seem to catch on and spread through social networks. So all together, it was just a really, really fun project to work on. And it's very nice to have hit makers out in the world.
I'm so glad that you do. And it's such a topical conversation. And everybody wants to be a hit maker these days. I don't know anybody who doesn't, right? So there's something in the culture that has certainly changed, because I don't think that it was always like that. You use the word hit maker, though, and I thought that was interesting, and I thought I had to ask you about that versus star or, you know, popular or whatever. Why did you say hit maker? Is it hitting on something?
Yeah, well, I guess fundamentally, this is, a book about stars would be a book about people. You know, people are stars. This is a book, though, about hits, about successful products, not only why we like those successful products, but also potentially how to make products that are successful. So I really wanted the emphasis here to be on the hits themselves, rather than make it a more of like a book of profiles about famous people.
Taking new ideas from their first thought or emanation and turning them into something meaningful, something successful, something popular, hit-makering, if you will. You say new is okay, but that people really don't like too new ideas. That fascinated me. Talk to us about that.
Yeah. Well, I just think that right now, you know, people feel so deluged by the amount of music and the number of articles and the books and the movies and the television shows on peak TV that they have to keep up with, that there's this enormous cultural pressure on liking new things and being aware of new things. So I think it makes it all the more interesting that the most fundamental theory of psychology, maybe, is this idea that mere exposure effect, which says that the most important bias in our brains is toward familiarity. We don't like things that are too new at all. In fact, what we really like are things that are sneakily familiar. We do enjoy hearing new songs, but we mostly like new songs that sound like songs we've already heard before. We love going to the movies from time to time, but every year this century, a majority of the top 10 films in the U.S. have been sequels, adaptations, and reboots. Familiar, familiar, familiar. I think even in the world of ideas, even in the world of people, maybe, if you think about, you know, a political or a semi-political idea that you hold very dearly, or even a friend that you've made in the last few years, you know, think a bit about, like, did I like this? Did I fall for this idea or this person because they were so blazingly new and original, or because there was something inside of me that recognized an element of surprising familiarity about them? I would guess that it's more of the latter. And that's why I talk so much in this book about this concept of familiar surprises, products and ideas that sit at the perfect intersection between new and old.
I'm going to say the word science. Let's talk science. Is this a science that you're doing? Is this what you... Because the title of your book has changed. I have different incarnations mm-hmm. along the way. Is there a science to this? Is that what you're getting at? Can we define it down to a thesis of some sorts? Or is there a certain amount of many other elements that are coming into it? Before we go ahead, I think we need to address that.
Yeah, I think that there is science to it, absolutely. I mean, you know, the two theses that I would say sort of hold up the book are, one, what I just said, the myth of novelty, and then second, the myth of virality, that we have this idea that, you know, in culture today, that if you make something that's great, it just self-distributes. It just goes viral. And that's just, it's just obviously wrong. When you talk to data scientists about how ideas spread through the internet, what they'll tell you is, look, we studied exactly how like an article or video seems to go viral, and when we look at the map of this thing catching on, it looks nothing like viral spread, something like the flu. It looks much more, frankly, like a series of diffuse broadcasts. And so there is both a psychological science to why we like what we like, but then to the latter story, there's a network science as well to understanding sort of how ideas move through social networks, and therefore how to engineer certain ideas for popularity.
Okay, let's stay with that, and let me just take you out on a little voyage with that. First of all, content. You know, the big line today is content is king. Does it matter if it's good content, bad content? Just content. How true is all of that? Content is king.
Well, yeah, content is king is certainly catchy. There's something to it to the extent that content, of course, matters. If you work in marketing or advertising, and you have, you know, a bunch of, I don't know, let's say just terrible products, terrible songs, terrible shirts that you have to market, you're going to have an awful, awful time because it's very difficult to market things that are terrible. So content is important. But what I say in the book is that content might be king, but distribution is the kingdom. Distribution is the way that you actually own the people that you want to reach. And so it's never, never enough to focus exclusively on content. Yes, you have to make something that you think is awesome. But then after that, you need to devise a distribution and marketing strategy rather than simply rely on the idea that, oh, because I made something that my mom or my sister said was great, it'll just naturally catch on.
So I have to ask you this. You have two people who create great content, great distribution channels, except one makes it and one doesn't. Why?
Sometimes Lady Luck just enters the scene. I mean, I love to say that there are some songs that are just destined to be hits, some distribution strategies that are totally fail-proof, but the answer from pop culture history is more complicated. The answer from pop culture history is that sometimes you have freak events that take off and create sort of historic moments. So one good example, I suppose, would be Rock Around the Clock. Rock Around the Clock comes out in 1954. It's a really not very successful song. It's a bit of a dud. And then several months later, it comes out again in 1955 in the movie Blackboard Jungle, which is a movie about sort of juvenile delinquency, a little bit like Rebel Without a Cause.
Glenn Ford. And, I have to throw that in. The beautiful Glenn Ford. I'm sorry.
Glenn Ford, there you go. Yeah, exactly. Absolutely. So right, Glenn Ford was the star. And the long story of this is really amazing. So Glenn Ford is having the director, Richard Brooks, over to his house in Los Angeles, and they need a song to kick off this movie, Blackboard Jungle, and they, Glenn Ford says, I am not going to be, a good person to give you sort of scary sounding music. I only listen to Hawaiian folk music. So he has his son, Peter Ford, give the director of Black Boy Jungle a stack of vinyl records to consider for the top of, to play at the top of the movie. And one of those records was Bill Haley and his Comets, Rock Around the Clock. And that song kicks off the movie, plays in the middle of the movie, plays at the end of the movie. And it's only then, after the movie comes out, that the song becomes the number one song in the country and ends up becoming, I think, the second best-selling song of all time in the U.S. So you have here the same song in consecutive years be a dud and then the hit of the century. So if content were king, if it were all about content, this story couldn't exist, right? You would say, well, you know, the song should have either been a pure hit or a pure flop and nothing in between. But it was something in between. It was both within the span of a year. And that suggests to me not only that distribution is really important, but also that there can be an element of flukiness to hits that's important for us to look at if we're going to be scientific and empirical about why things succeed. And so, yeah, I think there are ways to sort of manage the chaos of cultural markets and I guess, you know, enlist Lady Luck in your endeavors. But this is, you know, it's unreasonable to pretend that simply, you know, writing a good song and then leaving it alone is enough to create a hit.
Association, then, I think, does play a big part in all of this. And the genius marketers, if you will, are the ones who know how to play that game better than anybody else, I think. Don't you?
Yeah, I do think that a lot of it has to do with association. You know, I think about the... the Super Bowl ad for Tide. I don't know if you saw the Super Bowl, but there was this Tide commercial where they had the actor, the supporting actor from Stranger Things, essentially pretend to be in all sorts of other commercials, like a car commercial or a chips commercial or an insurance commercial, and then he kept sort of like breaking the fourth wall and saying, no, actually, this is a Tide ad. And so what they were essentially doing was playing on the idea that audiences are hyper familiar with ad formats for the Super Bowl. That within seconds they can say, oh, this is a car ad, this is a food ad. And here they were essentially playing on that and turning all of these ad formats into essentially platforms for Tide commercials. So again, the genius there is in the associations, as you said.
Yeah, I think that's really important. Okay, I have to say this line. Your publicist had this in her stuff. I'm just going to say it. Does size matter? What does that even mean?
Yeah, I know. I'm glad she put that in there. I think that the important thing about the size mattering issue is this: that it's actually a bit of a paradox. It's a bit more complicated than it seems. So first, a lot of people want to make their product as big as possible. They want to be as popular as possible. At the same time, though, if you make something for everybody all at once, ironically, what happens is you make it for nobody, because nobody is everybody, and everybody instead belongs to their own particular cult. It makes much more sense to make something for a small group of people that you can carefully target, because if you make something that they truly love, then they might be more likely to share it, ironically. And if they share it, then it has a chance of becoming truly popular. So essentially, to get big, aim small, I suppose.
Yeah, I had a very smart dad who used to say that, by the way. He used to say, stay in the small playground for a while, because that's where you're going to make the noise.
Interesting.
And I think that is interesting. Some things will spread further than others. And you discuss two things that I think fascinated me, broadcast mechanisms and social mechanisms. I want to bring in the word emotion here. I love the word emotion in the scope of all of what we're talking about. Have at it with that.
Emotion's a really, really interesting variable to include here in two ways. First, I talk about emotion with regard to nostalgia in the book. Nostalgia being something that's so important in modern culture, especially as You know, you have Disney and other television networks trying so hard to, you know, just bring back Will and Grace and bring back Murphy Brown and bring back Star Wars, bring back Indiana Jones, that clearly we have a rather, what would you call it, an obsession, you could say, with nostalgia in culture. And nostalgia sort of elicits powerful emotions. It not only connects people to the past, it also sort of allows them to sort of, you know, measure where they've come since they last consumed a certain product. And so nostalgia can be very emotional. At the same time, emotion plays a really large role in distribution as well. It's been shown that high arousal emotions, that is, not sadness, but outrage, not a small sense of cleverness, but a sense of something being awesome. These sort of high arousal emotions make us more likely to share something. And it makes, you know, sharing networks like Facebook and Twitter, you know, often seem somewhat sensationalist because it's essentially a competition to see who can share the most emotive message.
And the caveat there is we get back to what you were saying in the beginning, which is familiarity, yes, just not too much, maybe altered slightly, just enough to make it new. I think it's fascinating. I'm going to bring into this conversation, are you ready? You ready? You sitting down?
I'm ready.
Donald Trump.
Oh,
let's talk him, because look, you know, he's the master to some degree, or maybe he's not. What do you think in the context of what we've been talking about?
Well, it's complicated. Let me say a few things about Donald Trump with regard to this book. The first thing is that this is a book about popularity. And, you know, Donald Trump is not that popular. He's actually, like, the paradox of Trump is that he won a national popularity contest with fewer votes, and then upon becoming president, almost immediately became the least popular president in you know, modern history. So it's tough to say that Trump is popular in a majoritarian sense. That said, one interesting way that Trump sort of fits into one of the theses of this book is that I talk about, you know, familiar surprises, ideas that live at this intersection between the old and the new. And Trump is exactly that. On the one hand, he's an incredibly surprising face for the political scene, having never run for office before, really, or had any political office before, had any political experience. At the same time, his message was really extremely traditional. Make America Great Again is not a new idea for leading us into an unfamiliar future. It is returning us to the most familiar past we can imagine. And so he himself combines surprise and familiarity in precisely the way that I talk about in the book.
You talk in this book and about the phenomenon that tastes used to bubble from the top, and I think you use some music, and you can sing all you want if you want to bring some of those beats in.
Yeah.
But now they're trickling up from the bottom, and I think I can apply that with Trump. You may not want to go there, but I wanted to put that in there because that was something I was thinking. I think that's happening in the arts in general, in a lot of our popular culture. I don't know if it's a dumbing down. You may not think it is. I'm probably a little older than you, and I think that we're taking a hit on who becomes popular, what becomes popular. I don't think it's up to the standard that it might have been maybe 25 or even 30 years ago. So saying that to you, you can take it if you want, or if you want to ask me back something specific, you can talk to me.
Well, I think that you mentioned a couple of things in there that are interesting. The first is that it used to be a lot easier to dictate taste top down. And that's obviously true, that in an environment where you have only a handful of television stations, you have only a handful of radio stations, it's very easy for gatekeepers to use these scarce distribution channels to sort of push down popularity. You know, you control the means of distribution of a product, and therefore you can determine what people come to listen to over and over and over and over and over again, which tends to actually correlate with what they like. But today, that's really changed, I think. You have not one or, you know, not 10 local radio stations, but, you know, access to hundreds or thousands of radio stations, podcasts, included. It's not three television channels, it's 150, and that's not counting the streaming sites that offer their own sort of universe of abundance. And as a result, it's just very difficult to control popularity, and as a result, you have a shift from sort of top-down popularity to bottom-up popularity, which feels more chaotic, feels harder to control. But also, you know, the bright side, I suppose, would be that it does give certain creators who might have been overlooked by gatekeepers, it gives them a fighting chance in a way they didn't used to have it.
I like that concept. I think that's brilliant, and I think that's fairer, and it's more democratic, if you will. But the other side of the coin is, does crap, you know, get a better chance to percolate to the top than it used to? And I think that that's a real question. I think there, I sit around, you know, at dinner parties and whatever, and we all, everybody said, yeah, there's really, aren't any really great movies. You know, how many great books are there out there? You know, how, what the best group out there? It all sounds the same. Is there anything dynamic that's changed in the dynamics of all of this? That's good in terms of the artfulness of what's behind popularity.
Right. Well, I think toward the end of the book, I talk a little bit about sort of this very elusive concept of genius, which I think you're getting at, of artistry that stands the test of time and breaks away from the mainstream meaningfully in a way that is interesting and provocative. I definitely think, first of all, that there's lots of genius happening in books and in musical writing. I think that you know, while it might be harder for movies, any one particular movie, to be as central to culture as it was maybe in the 1980s, it's still, there's some fantastic movies that are being made, some excellent television. But to return to the concept of genius, you know, I talked to a lot of people who wanted to talk about Kid A, which is a Radiohead album, a very, very weird album that went platinum, sold a million copies. And what they said is, you know, there's no way that this album would have gone so big if it was Radiohead's first album. It has to have been, you know, one of their later albums, because they had to have already built up a certain amount of popularity before essentially trying to push forward the frontier of taste. And I think you can say the same about a lot of like great work, you know, like Sgt. Pepper and the White Album and Rubber Soul and some of those great Beatles albums, probably the most celebrated Beatles albums, you know, weren't their first or even their fourth, but like their seventh and ninth. The Beatles needed to have achieved a certain amount of popularity that they could say, now we don't need to care about making something that's purely to appease people. We can make something, now that we've mastered an element of mass appeal, we can make something that's truly brave. And I think that somewhere in that confidence of having mastered mass appeal and then pushing the vanguard forward just a little bit, that's really where genius lives. I suppose you could say the same about a work like, you know, Schindler's List or something, like Steven Spielberg. You have someone who completely mastered, you know, pop entertainment with Close Encounter and Jaws, and then said, you know, you said, like, you know, I now want to make something that's not just fun, but it's something more like art. But maybe it took him being popular to produce something that was genius.
We have to wait to see, though, what really happens in all of this, because you look at that, you know, looking at the films that are nominated this year for the Academy Award, and who are the likely winners. And although there are one or two that are I think, brilliant, and of course that's all subjective, the tendency seems to be that things that are more popular, you know, are the things that get there, not necessarily the real art get to the top.
Well, can I ask what movies you like that are up for Oscars?
I thought that Churchill's Dark Hours was absolutely brilliant from everything from lighting to music to performance to storyline to depth, and a lot of the others were clever by half, been there, done that. I'm older than you, as I said. you know, been around, mm-hmm. came out of the movie industry, if you will. It would have been B movies years ago, to be honest. Joe Wright.
Yeah, interesting. But I think that's really interesting because, there's two things there. First, I would say that I don't know that it's just the case that the Oscars right now are a pure popularity contest, since the movies with the most nominations, like Shape of Water or Lady Bird or Three Billboards, I don't think any of them got over $100 million in the box office. I don't think Darkest Hour did either. So these tend to be slightly smaller movies than, you know, certainly something like Jumanji. But I guess the second thing would be that, you know, tastes change in really interesting ways over time, such that they can seem, you know, sometimes to be like that people can have an experience like yours where you say, you know, I really enjoyed this sort of traditional biopic, but I felt like, you know, these other movies that seem to be getting a lot of buzz just like really aren't my style. You know, it's possible that it's other people's style and that the style has changed. It's also possible, I suppose, that taste is just merely very elusive. That which we call genius is essentially a sort of collective decision that a culture makes years after we can blindly evaluate or adequately, objectively evaluate a piece of content's worth, because the content just becomes something more than, in this case, a movie. You know, something like The Godfather or Star Wars or Casablanca. You know, these are not movies anymore. It's not possible to see them in 2018 the same way you would see Lady Bird or some new movie with no expectations. They come burdened with this enormous weight of huge expectations, and they aren't even, I think, as Umberto Eco once said regarding Casablanca, we're so familiar with so many of their beats that they become like a reunion of cliches. And of course, there are many cliches in all these movies, Casablanca, Star Wars, and even The Godfather now is somewhat cliche just because it's so overly quoted. And so seeing the movie is like sort of having a nostalgia trip down culture lane and you know, seeing this cliche reunion.
But that happens at anything.
But it becomes hard to evaluate them as pure movies.
Right, but that becomes true of anything that's been on the pike for a certain amount of time. And then we get back to what I was saying in the beginning, was if this, to me, it's almost a dumbing down of ideas or a cheapening of our culture. And you know, I won't say what I think politically, because I think that's a ramification of some of that to some degree. You know, hello, you know, who am I to say it? But, you know, I'm certainly entitled to the opinion. So I think these things all play a huge part in all of this. And I think your book is brilliant because it really makes you think. You hit all cylinders.
Thank you very much.
Derek, it's really a terrific piece, I have to tell you. But at the end of the day, I'm going to say to you, science, fairy dust, you know what? They may be more intertwined than we ever thought before, and I think you probably agree. Thank you.
Thank you. I do agree. I think the science and the fairy dust can live together.
And listen to me. I'm just saying that between you and I, it stays in the thing. At the end of the day, this is a brilliant piece of that should percolate to the top and go viral. Darlin, thank you.
I appreciate that.
All right. I've been speaking with Derek Thompson. His book, Hitmakers, The Science of Popularity in an Age of Distraction, is now available in paperback at fine bookstores everywhere. Thank you so much for tuning in to Talkish, the Halli Casser-Jayne Show, a production of Resec LLC. Be sure to tune in to Talkish Wednesdays, 3 p.m. Eastern, when new podcasts are posted at hallicasserjayne.com. Until next time, this is Halli Casser-Jayne.